I'm Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor for Radiology, and I'm here today to introduce the podcast for the March issue of Radiology. The very first one is with myself and Dr. Christoph Lee, and we discuss the paper done by his group from Washington on cost-effectiveness of adjunct digital breast tomosynthesis for screening women with dense breasts. This is a very timely paper that looks at how tomosynthesis performs and the cost-benefit analysis of adding this on as an adjunct to screening with digital mammography. I think you'll find it to be very, very interesting. The next paper is also a very interesting study, and it is entitled Reporting Diagnostic Accuracy Studies Still Improving After 9 Years of STARD. So for many of our readers, you might hear us talking about STARD in some of our papers, and what it stands for is the Standards for Reporting of Diagnostic Accuracy Tests. And Dr. Daniël Korevaar from the Academic Medical Center, University of Amsterdam, in the Department of Epidemiology, Biostatistics and Bioinformatics in the Netherlands, his group has really worked on STARD and on updating STARD and on making sure, or at least evaluating, how people are using this particular statement in their results publishing. And so we've, in radiology, have published a number of studies from this group. This is the most recent update on STARD, and I think you'll find it very interesting. It's really important for our authors to know about how they should be putting together their studies for diagnostic imaging studies and how we evaluate them as editors and as reviewers. So I hope our readers find these two podcasts interesting, and we'll look forward to seeing you next month. Hi, I'm Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor for Radiology, and I'm here today with Dr. Christoph Lee, who's an Assistant Professor of Radiology and an Adjunct Assistant Professor of Health Services at the University of Washington School of Medicine. He's also a faculty investigator at the Hutchinson Institute for Cancer Outcomes Research. He and his group wrote an article entitled Comparative Effectiveness of Combined Digital Mammography and Tomosynthesis Screening for Women with Dense Breasts that's coming out in the March issue of Radiology. So, Dr. Lee, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So, can you tell us a bit about what you did and what you found?
Sure. So, I guess the background for this study really is driven by the breast density reporting legislation. So far, 21 states in the U.S. have adopted a law requiring radiology facilities to directly inform women that they have heterogeneously extremely dense breasts by mammography and that they may be at increased risk for developing breast cancer during their lifetime, and then to have a discussion with their primary care physician about possible supplemental screening beyond digital mammography. Right now, 4 states that have insurance coverage for supplemental screening are really for screening ultrasound. And this is a different modality with low sensitivity after a negative mammogram. And tomosynthesis, having FDA approval in 2011, is really gaining steam. We felt that tomosynthesis would have a positive effect for women with dense breasts by getting rid of focal asymmetries that are overlapping fibroglandular tissue and exposing the small invasive cancers that are masked by dense breasts. So we wanted to see if combined screening with both digital mammography and digital breast tomosynthesis for women with dense breasts would be a cost-effective approach from a payer perspective.
So how exactly did you do your cost-effectiveness analysis?
So we partnered with several groups, one with CISNET, that's the National Cancer Institute funded group, that's Cancer Intervention and Surveillance Modeling Network. And we used the same model that was used for the cost effectiveness analysis for DMIST, the digital mammography imaging screening trial. We also partnered with the Breast Cancer Surveillance Consortium, which is also funded by NCI and is the largest database for screening in the U.S. There's about 7% of the screening population, and their registries are shown to be representative in terms of demographic characteristics of the entire U.S. population. So what we did was take input parameters in terms of performance of digital mammography from the BCSC, and also performance data that's coming out of the European trials, specifically the Oslo trial in Norway for tomosynthesis. And we combined Medicare reimbursement rates for costs and also utilization rates from the Breast Cancer Surveillance Consortium to map out diagnostic costs and treatment costs from the literature. And we took all this data, included in the microsimulation model, and we used the Wisconsin-Harvard model, the same that was used for the DMIS cost effectiveness analysis.
And, you know, just as a bottom line, what did you find for whether this is cost effective or not?
Right. So in health economic terms, we have the incremental cost effectiveness ratio, which means the cost per quality adjusted life year. The threshold for cost effectiveness is about $100,000. And what we found with the combined screening compared to mammography alone for women with dense breasts, the ICER was about $53,000 and change. So it was highly cost effective. I should mention that we used moderate improvements in sensitivity and specificity for combined screening. We did not use what is actually being seen in Oslo because we feel that we're not gonna get that type of high performance in the US. In Europe, they have double reads for screening. In the US, we have single reads. So we used what's being seen in Oslo as the upper limit in our sensitivity analysis. So we use more conservative estimates for our base case analysis. So we think that these are really conservative estimates, and it seems like combined screening is going to be highly cost effective.
Now, one issue that is a little bit difficult in applying your results to the United States is that you looked at the biennial screening, because that's what they did in that Oslo trial. Whereas in the United States, we tend to do annual screening. And I'm wondering if you can talk about how that could affect your results.
Right, so I think that's a great point. Unfortunately, we don't have any prospective data from the United States with annual screening. All the information with combined 2D and 3D mammography is really coming out of the from Europe, both in Italy and Norway, and they use biannual screening. It's unknown what annual screening with combined 2D and 3D mammography would do. What we do know is that we're collecting the data now, and we'll be able to look at that a few years down the road. But unfortunately, we just don't have the data to say anything about that.
And when do you think the BCSC will have that data on tomosynthesis to give us an idea of using this prospectively in clinical practice?
Good point. So we've been collecting that for the last few years, and we plan to continue collecting that into the future. Our analyses involving tomosynthesis data will probably be happening in about a year or two.
Well, we'll look forward to seeing that for sure. Another issue that arises is tomosynthesis is changing, and the reconstructed 3D views are now being used instead of always having this as an add-on on top of digital mammography. And I'm wondering how that kind of reconstructed view might change your findings.
So early reports out of Europe are showing that the synthetic 2D view that's taken off the 3D sweep is just as effective in terms of diagnostic accuracy as the standard 2D mammography. If we believe that, then the results of this cost effectiveness analysis should not change. We actually considered this, and we actually did not put in a disutility for radiation risk because we believe that the 2D synthetic view, which is FDA approved as of May 2013 in the US, will eventually catch on pretty quickly. And there won't be a need for combined screening, in which case 3D mammography alone would be the standard. If that were to happen, our results, we performed the study in a way that the results would still be valid.
And when we look at tomosynthesis, it's not just that more cancers might be found. In fact, some studies don't show more cancers, but what all the studies seem to show is decreasing the need for follow-up and decreasing the need for biopsies. And I was wondering how that impacted your modeling.
Right. That's a great question. So there's some debate as to how much increased cancer detection there is with tomosynthesis. In Europe, they're seeing a 25% bump in cancer detection rate, which is quite significant. They're also seeing a 15 to 17% reduction in recall rates. What we did with our sensitivity analysis is see what would happen in the population if there was no improvement in sensitivity, just improvement in specificity. So if we only do a moderate improvement in the decrease in recall rates and absolutely no improved cancer detection rate, the cost effectiveness of the combined screening still approaches the $100,000 threshold. The value for that is about $104,447. So what we're seeing is that even with no improvement in cancer detection and just decreased recalls, it's still a cost-effective approach.
Wonderful. And, you know, getting down to the impact of healthcare policy research like this, do you think that a study like this and your findings can actually affect healthcare policy in the United States?
Well, that's our hope. What we learned from digital mammography and the adoption of a new technology in screening was that the evidence really lagged behind policy. By the time that CMS had reimbursements for digital mammography and CAD in 2000-2001, digital mammography was being adopted rapidly. And by the time the DMIST results came back and the cost effectiveness from the DMIST in 2008, it was too late. The technology had been adopted. And while there's hope that there would be a randomized controlled trial in the US involving tomosynthesis, that hasn't been established and hasn't started. So we wouldn't have results even if it started today for another 5 to 7 years. And by that time, now that CMS has given a CPT code for tomosynthesis, it's unlikely to have an effect. So what we saw in the state of Washington actually was that in this analysis and additional cost effectiveness analysis we did for screening ultrasound published in a different journal, these two studies together affected policy this past January in the state of Washington. Washington's different in that their state coverage, insurance coverage for new technologies is decided by a 10-person technology assessment committee from the Washington State Health and Care Authority. And the two topics on their docket this January was tomosynthesis screening, combined screening with TB, and screening ultrasound for women with dense breasts. In our model, we saw that adding tomosynthesis for screening of women with dense breasts would avert one cancer death per 2,000 women screened. It would also avert 405 false positives per 1,000 women screened. With ultrasound, we were seeing that we divert less cancer deaths per 1,000 women screened, and also creates hundreds of unnecessary benign biopsies. So ultrasound was going in a different direction from tomosynthesis. At the end of the day, I served as a clinical expert for the Technology Assessment Committee. And based on the evidence, they adopted and will cover tomosynthesis screening in the state of Washington, but they will not cover screening ultrasound.
Interesting. And did they put a cost to that coverage? Because everybody wants to know, what will we eventually be paid for this?
Right. So in our model, we used an estimate of $50. This was before CMS decided on an add-on CPT code. As of January 1st of this year, CMS is reimbursing $56.57 for the add-on tomosynthesis. So that would be added on to the 2D mammography charge or cost. It worked out perfectly. So our model actually did a great estimate for the cost. So our cost effectiveness analysis applies quite nicely to what's happening. Our assumption is that most major payers are going to follow CMS with about the same rate of reimbursement.
Well, that's wonderful. I really appreciate you taking the time. I know you're at a meeting in La Jolla right now, so taking time away from that to speak with us. But this is obviously a topic, a hot topic in imaging research and in breast care imaging and breast care for women. And I really appreciate the work that you've done. So thank you so much for your time.
Pleasure. Thank you, Dr.
Hi, I'm Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor for Radiology, and I'm here today speaking with Dr. Daniël, who is a PhD student at Academic Medical Center, University of Amsterdam, in the Department of Clinical Epidemiology, Biostatistics, and Bioinformatics in the Netherlands. He and his group did a very interesting study looking at how we use STARD. And the title of that study is Reporting Diagnostic Accuracy Studies, Still Improving After 9 Years of STARD. And this will be in the March issue of Radiology. So Dr. Korevaar, welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, very happy to be here.
So can you tell me just a little bit about the rationale for STARD in general, and then why you wanted to undertake this study?
Yes, of course. So STARD is a reporting guideline that was launched in 2003, and it was developed by an international group of about 80 researchers, editors, journalists, physicians, people, stakeholders involved in developing or assessing the relevance of diagnostic accuracy studies. And the point of START is to increase the transparency and completeness of reporting of these diagnostic accuracy studies. So START was launched in response to increasing evidence in the biomedical literature of relatively poor reporting of these studies. Diagnostic accuracy studies evaluate how well an index test, which is a test under evaluation, discriminates between patients with and without a target condition. And we can only assess the usefulness of the results of such a study and the applicability of the studies to our own clinical setting if the reporting of the study is complete, so we know what where the patients came from, how tests were performed, things like that. So our START aims to improve that, and it does so by providing a checklist of 25 items that are all most important elements from a study report. And if all these 25 items are reported, then the paper can be considered as scientifically and clinically informative. And so since 2000, START was launched, over 200 biomedical journals have adopted the checklist. So decided to evaluate these journals currently adhere to the STAR checklist.
So your group had done a similar study looking before and after STARD and had found some uptake of these reporting guidelines, but wanted more improvement. What did you do this time that was different from your prior study?
We more or less did an update. So START was launched in 2003, and a previous evaluation from my group compared studies that were published in 2000 with those that were published in 2004. So before START and after START, and these diagnostic accuracy studies were all published in 12 high impact journals in 2000 and 2004. And so they evaluated whether START had an impact. And they found a small but significant improvement over time, but still many study reports turned out to be incomplete. But of course, the authors concluded that since it was only 1 year after the launch of START, it may have been way too early to expect very large improvements. So we decided, it's now been almost 10 years after the launch of START, to evaluate, well, what has happened in these 10 years. Were there major improvements in the reporting? So what we did, we took the same 12 journals that had been evaluated before, and tried to identify all diagnostic accuracy studies that had been published in 2012, then to review independently assessed all these diagnostic accuracy studies according to the 25 items on the STAR checklist. There were our results. It should be noted that all 12 journals had an impact factor of over 6 in 2012, and all but one, only one of these journals was not adopter. All the other journals were STAR adopters, which means that they indicate in their author guidelines that expect authors to use the STAR checklist.
So So just for our listeners, so that they understand the context of this, you have general medical journals like the Annals of Internal Medicine, Archives of Internal Medicine, JAMA, Lancet, and then you had discipline-specific journals like neurology and radiology. And I'm wondering if you can tell us what differences you found. For example, imaging tests seem to have more items documented than laboratory tests. Why would you think that would occur?
So we included 112 studies from all different research fields, because a diagnostic test can be anything from an imaging test to a laboratory test, but also, for example, physical examination or a good a proper medical history. And we found that half of these were the imaging tests. If we look at the overall number of items reported, it turned out to be 15.3 out of 25. So it was the average number of items reported across all these 112 studies. And we noticed a significant improvement compared to 2000 and 2004. So compared to 2000, we found that 3.5 more items were reported in 2012 compared to 2004, 1.7 items. So we concluded that the quality of reporting had slowly but gradually been increasing, but was still suboptimal for many articles. So we had a bit of mixed feelings because, well, on average, still 10 items were not reported in these study reports. And I must admit, we had expected a bit more, considering that these are all top journals, and all of them, most of them, adopting START. And to come back to your question, so we made a comparison between publications from radiology journals or assessing a radiology test, an imaging test, with those assessing laboratory tests or other types of tests. And we noticed that imaging tests, on average, perform better than these two other groups. So on average, 17 items were reported in the imaging group compared to 14 in the laboratory medicine group and 14.5 in the other types of tests.
And do you think that might be because the 25 items, while they each individually make sense, probably some are more important to certain types of articles than others, and people are using their own judgment on including these, or do you think people just haven't paid attention to the checklist?
Well, that's a difficult question, of course, because it's very difficult for us to assess whether people even are aware of START. I mean, it's in the author guidelines of most of these journals, but we don't know whether authors really properly read these author guidelines. So one explanation could be that laboratory medicine is maybe more exploratory in nature and also covers in the same study report other outcomes than the diagnostic accuracy part. So in the same, let's say, 3,000 words, they have to cover multiple outcomes. So it may be more difficult to report all the items that are on the START checklist. That being said, in an era where you can put an unlimited amount of information on the internet, I think this is not a very good excuse, because, well, you can add appendices, which covers the data. So, what the explanation could be for the difference between the research fields, I'm not really sure about that. But if we look at our data, it seems that a proportion of studies is very complete in its reporting, and definitely made an improvement compared to studies that were published 10 years ago. But there are still a large amount of studies that, well, they do not seem to use START. So they only score, if you look at the 25 items, they only report, well, maybe between 5 and 10. So I don't think they've seen the checklist or considered the checklist appropriate.
Yeah, you know, for a while, we definitely sent the STARD checklist to every diagnostic accuracy study, and we still do, but we need to think about doing that and make it be something active that we do in the journal process. It might be that some kind of widget during the submission process would be helpful so that authors would know they have to do X, Y, and Z before they submit. But we have so much information out there for in our information for authors. You're right, it probably does get kind of lost in the mix. And yet we feel it's really important for diagnostic accuracy studies. If other people want to be able to replicate the study, you want them to know exactly, you know, what was done. So I strongly believe we should think about this and encourage other journals to do as well. Were you surprised about any specific items that had particularly poor compliance?
Well, as you can see in our paper, there was a large variability in reporting of items. So some items were reported quite properly, while others, performed much worse. There are some important items, I think, that relate to risk of bias in a study, and that performed quite poor. So, for example, item 5, whether patients were how they were sampled, so was it a consecutive series of patients or a non-consecutive series? Only half of the studies reported this element, while non-consecutive sampling of patients is a known factor of bias in diagnostic accuracy studies. And the same applies, for example, to blinding. So only about half of all the studies reported whether the readers of the index test were blinded to the results of the reference standard, and only one-third of the studies reported whether the readers of the reference standard were blinded to the results of the index test. And of course, if readers of one test are aware of the results of the other test, agreement between the two tests is likely to increase. So we should have an idea whether they were blinded or not. And we don't. So it's very difficult to assess review bias, as we call it. Also quite striking is that number 21, so estimates of diagnostic accuracy and confidence intervals, all the reported or the included diagnostic accuracy studies reported on estimates of accuracy, because that's an inclusion criterion, but one-third does not provide confidence intervals. I think that point of accuracy should always be interpreted with measure of imprecision, because otherwise it's very easy to add spin to your results or to leave have an overinterpretation of your results. And this happens quite frequently among diagnostic accuracy studies, as a colleague of mine has shown last year in a paper that was also published in Radiology.
Now, one element that you mentioned specifically in the paper was about statements on study safety. And I know from some of the articles that we publish, if a safety evaluation was not a formal part of the study design, then we don't require diagnostic accuracy studies to mention that. So it might be that some of these terms aren't applicable for some papers. What would you think about a comment such as that?
So that's definitely an issue. That's something we mentioned in the limitation section. We can't expect authors to report all these 25 items, because not all these 25 items may be applicable to every study. So indeed, safety outcomes, adverse events, it may not be applicable to every diagnostic test. And the same could apply to some of the other items. So 25 items, we don't expect that. But there are some crucial items that I think should be in any study report. And there are some items, that may be less relevant in some situations. So therefore, we also try to focus on individual items, and especially in the discussion section, focus on items that were poorly reported and we think are crucial.
Sure. And you know, you mentioned how important it is to be blinded in your assessments, and yet your own reviewers weren't blinded to the journals that were being done. Of course, this is inevitable in many ways because of the content of the journal articles and the style of the journals. But do you think this could have added some bias to your reviews?
So that we weren't blinded to the journal, you mean?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I wouldn't see why that would have biased our results. So we have strict definitions of how to score an item. I agree that some of the items are on the star checklist may be multi-interpretable. So we, for example, there may be items that we didn't consider to be sufficiently reported while the peer reviewer, when reading the paper, considered to be sufficiently addressed. But we had strict criteria, the same criteria that were used in 2000 and 2004, and we handled the papers accordingly.
All right. I have another question that confused me when I first read your paper. You talk about single gate and multiple gate as terms that you use to categorize the different studies. And our readers might not be familiar with those terms. So I'm wondering if you can just talk about what they mean to you and why results would differ in these groups.
Okay, so I noticed that a lot of people struggle with these terms. What do we mean by a single gate study is more of a cohort type study, and a multiple gate is more of a case control type study. So a multiple gate study, more or less the definition is that it has different inclusion criteria for the cases and for the controls. So for the patients with the target condition and the patients without the target condition, while in a single gate or a cohort study, one set of criteria is defined and inclusion criteria for each patient. So in a multiple gate study, patients are usually selected after undergoing the reference standard, while in a single gate study, they don't necessarily have to. So every patient suspected of the target condition undergoes then both the index test and the reference standard. And the reason why we made this distinction is that case control studies have shown to lead to overestimations of diagnostic accuracy compared to single gate or cohort studies. And the reason for that is probably that, for a test to make a distinction between, very extreme cases of disease and healthy controls, it's probably much more easier than detecting the target condition in that are all suspected of having this disease.
Great, thank you. So here's a little bit of a leading question. Do you think that starred compliant papers are better than non-compliant papers?
You mean, they're definitely better in their reporting, I assume, but you probably refer to whether the study methodology is better, whether the results are more credible. And that's a question we can't answer from our results, but it's very important to realize that we scored reporting quality and not methodological quality, and that's a mistake that's often made. START is a reporting guideline and does not prescribe any methodology. So if you look at systematic reviews of diagnostic accuracy studies, we very often see that they use START to assess the methodological quality of included diagnostic accuracy studies. And this is not correct. A study can be very poor in its methodology, but very complete in its reporting. So we don't make statements about the quality of the study, but about the reporting quality of the study. Another question is whether poor methodology is often hidden behind poor reporting. That may be the case. I hope it's not, but there's no evidence around that.
Yeah, so I think you bring up a very important point. We would like to have excellent methodology and excellence in our reporting as well for any study in the biomedical literature. So now that START's been around for a while, I know that your START group recently met again and decided to update START. I'm wondering if you can tell us what led to that decision and what major changes we should expect going forward.
From the new START list. So yeah, the new START checklist has been under development now for over a year, and we hope to publish it somewhere, me and the whole START group consisting of more than 80 people, somewhere in at the end of this year. So the reason for updating is that some of the elements may have been outdated. We wanted to find whether there had become new evidence around sources of bias, sources of applicability, but also that we noticed that there were some language problems with the START checklist. Some of the items are not very easy to interpret for any researcher in any research field. So, it was also a good moment to make sure that everybody understands the checklist. Things have also changed in these past 10 years. For example, more and more studies are being registered data sharing is becoming much more often. So, for example, the concert checklist for randomized controlled trials already contains items such as please report your registration number, please report where readers can find the original protocol. So we also wanted to address those things. So, yeah, enough reason to think about an update.
That sounds great. And will you have some kind of online presence where people can go and maybe you know, look at the checklist and just check things off as they're going along and planning as well as reporting their studies?
So not for the update, no, unfortunately. There is a website for the start statement, but it is a bit outdated because we are making a transition now to what to put the start checklist on the Equator website. So details can be found about start can be found on the Equator website, which contains a clear heading of start. But there, I must admit, is not a lot of info about the update of the start checklist. So yeah, I guess interested people should have to wait a few more months.
Well, we'll definitely look forward to seeing that. I can tell you, again, our journal feels very strongly that we want to have as complete and accurate reporting of diagnostic imaging tests as possible. And that means we ask a lot of our authors and a lot of our reviewers when they go through this. But I really appreciate the time and effort your group has put together in creating STARD, evaluating it, and updating it. It's a great service to our publishing community. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.